Hey there, today I have decided to start recording new videos for my YouTube channel, addressing new or different topics from the one that I have shown you already. Regarding seismic design of structure, of course, I always talk about seismic design. I have already shown you how to apply ELF or response spectrum analysis inside ETAP's software. I show you step by step how to compute the response manually. But I didn't show you yet how to perform nonlinear dynamic time history analysis or pushover analysis. Therefore, this is my aim in this recorded course to show you more methods regarding seismic design of a structure, okay? But before we dive into today's lesson, I want to thank each one of you who has already subscribed to my channel. And for those who haven't subscribed yet, I extend a warm invitation to you to become a part of my channel by hitting that subscribe button. And now let's get started. My primary reason is to offer you a comprehensive review of the upcoming content using this PowerPoint, okay? This is one of my completed projects. I will show you this project as an example because at the end I want you to know from now what you will expect at the end of watching my videos. This will provide you with an overview of the core ideas, let's say, that is located in this course, okay? Then let's start. Regarding seismic analysis methods, we have already talked about ELF and RSA. I have just talked about the linear response history analysis a little bit. I have shown you just how to import the ground motion text file into ETAPS. And till now, I didn't talk anything about pushover analysis or nonlinear response history analysis. What I want to make clear about is the difference between linear and nonlinear analysis. In linear analysis, we are assuming that the material will stay in its elastic range and it will never experience any inelastic behavior. Therefore, that's why we can say we are performing linear analysis, because we are just assuming that the material itself will stay in its elastic range. But the thing in nonlinear analysis is a little bit different. We need to consider the nonlinear behavior of material. We need to know after this concrete or this steel cracks, what happens. That's all the difference. Therefore, in order to perform nonlinear analysis, we need the stress strain diagram of the material itself. If it was concrete or steel or anything, we need to go and to obtain the stress strain diagram of that material in order to perform nonlinear analysis, okay? This is the main difference between both methods, let's say. In this project, I used this multi-tower building sharing common podium. This is the first building I used. It's called SH, let's agree on that. This is because those two towers have the same height, while the second building have towers with different height, and I name it as DH, okay? You can get here some general info about F prime C, number of stories, seismic weight, and etc. Regarding load combo, I have already shown you how to define those load combo. And regarding the EQX, of course, we can use ELF in different project in this load combo. Here I'm using response spectrum method as the seismic force in the inside this load combination. Actually, the reason for doing that, ELF is not permitted to be used for buildings higher than 60 meter, okay? And this building is 108 meter in height, then ELF shouldn't be used. Also, this building is considered to be irregular, therefore we cannot use ELF. Regarding the spectrum, I have shown you how to develop the spectrum for different damping event. I shown you previously how to develop the spectrum for 5% for 2.5% damping ratio. And what I want you to notice here that those two buildings, I will be design them for two locations. The first location is called Bangkok zone and the second is Chiang Mai zone. Those two locations are located in Thailand, okay? The third thing I want you to notice in this slide also that 2.5% damping ratio is used actually because I'm assuming that this building and this one have 2.5% damping ratio. As you all know, that when we deal with high-rise building, we assume that the damping should be reduced. And normally we use 2.5. And if we are dealing with low building, let's say, or short building, we can assume that the damping is 5%. As the building height increases, as the damping should be decreased, okay? This is the third thing I said. And regarding the nonlinear dynamic time history analysis, if we want to apply this method or to use this method, we need real earthquake ground motion text file. And to make the things compatible to each other, for example, at the end, if we want to compare response spectrum analysis and the results obtained from nonlinear dynamic time history analysis, if we want to compare the results, we should make sure that our ground motion could be used and they are compatible to the other methods. What I'm trying to say, I have already shown you that in my YouTube channel, maybe in this video lecture 18, that each ground motion have its own pseudo-spectral acceleration, which is shown here in this graph here. This is the pseudo-spectral acceleration of a ground motion one that having a damping ratio of 0.025. What this means? This means that we have used a single degree of a freedom system that have a 2.5% damping, and with a specific period or natural frequency, we have used this ground motion as a force. We obtain the response of this single degree of freedom system that have a specific period and specific damping ratio. We obtain the response from that using a numerical technique. We have solved the equation of motion. I have shown you step by step how to do it even in this video, okay? Therefore, at the end, we should, let's say, make sure that the pseudo-spectral acceleration of from each ground motion have similar shape to the target spectrum that should be used here in a response spectrum analysis. As shown here, the mean or the average results of all these six ground motion give very close results to the target spectrum. Therefore, we can say, okay, those two methods are now compatible to each other. We can make this comparison between those two methods. Also, the one thing I want to mention before leaving this slide, normally when we are doing nonlinear dynamic time history analysis, it's not enough to base our final answer just using one ground motion. As you can see here, I'm using six ground motions to make this study. And actually for Chiang Mai location, I have used 10 ground motions. Therefore, we need to use also many ground motions and to take, let's say, the average results, and we will say that those are the most accurate results, and we will compare all other methods with this results obtained from nonlinear dynamic time history analysis. Okay, regarding the selection of stiffness, I have shown you also how to change the flexural stiffness. Yeah, this one, lecture 14. In this project, I have did the things a little bit different. Let me show you. After I have defined this load combination, which is the design load combination of response spectrum analysis, we scaled up with this scale factor, which is the ratio of base shear from ELF and the base shear from response spectrum analysis. This is the reduced response. As you can see, I have multiplied the total combined response by I over R. Therefore, I have used this load combo plus 0.9 of the dead loads, and I have used this load combo to check the tensile stresses. I didn't use this one as I have did before in my YouTube. Okay, please note this. This is very important because we should agree that at least 90% of the dead loads are present. The self-weight of concrete, the finishing material, I don't know what. Therefore, we need, if we want to be realistic, we want to include those portion of loads with the seismic force obtained from response spectrum analysis to check the tensile stresses. Here, the tensile stresses of same height building located in Bangkok site, here in Chiang Mai site. Okay, the second important thing that I have did different from my YouTube channel here in this slide, that if this wall cracks at the bottom, I should just reduce the flexural stiffness of the cracked wall to be 0.35. I don't need to go and reduce this portion of the wall to be 0.35. I can keep this to be uncrack, and I should consider this to be crack, okay? Because what I have also did in my previous uploaded video on YouTube here in this video, if the wall crack at the base, I select all the walls in all stories and I reduce all of them to be 0.35. And in this way, I'm being too conservative and there is no need to do this. We just need to change the flexural stiffness of the cracked wall, okay? This is the two things that we should understand. Maybe I will skip all of those. We will come back later to them. But at the end, you will be able to do something like that. Let me show you the final results. The black line here, and let's focus here on story shear first. This is same height building, SH. In EQX, this means the seismic force is applied in the X direction. The base shear is just normalized by the seismic weight of the structure. For example, the story displacement is normalized by the total height, H, which is 108 meters. This is the story drift ratio. They normally just normalized by the story height itself. Story shear are normalized by the seismic weight, and the moments or bending moments are normalized by weight multiplied by the total height of the structure. This is just normalization of the results. It makes things easier to notice. For example, you can say, oh, the base shear is 6% of the weight of the structure. In this way, what we can notice here, the most important thing in story shear, that nonlinear response history analysis is giving us this results, this shape of story shear. And the response spectrum analysis, which is this one, is giving 2%. Even I have put the values here. It's 1.9%, sorry. The ELF gives a little bit higher results. The nonlinear analysis is too way far from the base shear obtained from these two methods that we have already talked about on my YouTube channel. This shows why it is not allowed to use these methods to design such buildings. Okay, this is just the idea. This is really unsafe to use or to design such buildings using RSA or ELF. Regarding, for example, story displacement, we can check that RSA giving close result, not exactly same. Actually, it's underestimating the nonlinear curve, the black bold line. But what we should also remember, let's say, about RSA, we need to multiply displacements obtained from RSA by the amplification displacement factor, CD. Therefore, this is the importance of using CD, the factor I have shown you previously, maybe in one of the slides. Yeah, this is CD equal to 5. Because if we didn't use CD, therefore the dotted red line will be very far from the nonlinear real curve, let's say. That's why we need to use CD. We need to amplify displacement, trying to predict the real response under real earthquake. And that's why ACI code 318.19, they have suggested a new method to compute story shear by multiplying the design base shear obtained from RSA by the overstrength factor. And I think there is another parameter. Also, we will talk about this method in details later on, okay? Those are the results of all buildings that I have designed. In all cases, RSA and ELF, they really underestimate the nonlinear results. Also, I will try to show you these proposed methods of computing shear forces. For example, the red bold line, this is the method proposed by ACI code 318.19. As you can see that it gives closer results to the real behavior of the structure. This structure also here, as you can see that the ACI code amplification method, let's name it, it provides good estimate of shear forces, let's say. This is for same height structure in Chiang Mai site, here in X direction, here in Y direction. Here it gives a great matching with the nonlinear response history analysis, actually. Also, there are more proposed methods, as you can see. There is something called modified response spectrum analysis. This is based on higher mode elastic approach. This is why here we have E, while this is based on higher mode inelastic approach. Also, these two methods, I have used them in my thesis. The idea was based on those two methods, how to estimate or to propose a new method that can estimate, let's say, story shear and shear forces in irregular tall buildings. This is the end, actually, of this video. I will say that this is fine for now as an introduction. And if you find the topic I'm covering interesting, I encourage you to stay tuned for my upcoming video.